how to achieve glowing health and vitality. And we have two experienced doctors here speaking about the subject on the 10-point guide to health and vitality. So we have Dr. Amit Agarwal, whom I will invite on stage. Dr. Amit Agarwal has more than 15 years of practicing experience and is a Kriyaban with us, and he is running, he serves at the Vita Life Clinic as a general physician. He has co-founded the Ananda Integrated Medical Healthcare Clinic along with Brahmachari Dr. Aditya Gate, who is the speaker co-partnering with Dr. Amit Agarwal. Brahmachari Aditya Gate has served in the medical emergency department of the Apollo Hospital at Lavasa. He also comes with, he's also been coming with extensive experience in running rural camps and medical clinics. Is both of them together serve at the Ananda Integrated Medical Health Care Clinic in Pune. So we hope you can visit the clinic sometime. It is in Bhosle Nagar. And now I would like to invite Brahmachari Aditya Gate onto the stage for the class. Thank you.
I'll briefly share that my friendship with Dr. Amar goes back now almost 9 years, 8-9 years. And Kriyananda ji, who was a direct disciple of Paramhansa Yogananda, he told us both that in time, he said, it'll be nice if we could bring clarity to the teachings of health. That health is very vast. I often tell people that I spent 7.5 years, you know, first in medical school, then I was pursuing my post-graduation in surgery, studying and learning many different things. But what I found in this small little book, which is available in our health stall outside, called How to Achieve Glowing Health and Vitality, I said surpassed by far everything I had read in those big, heavy volumes. Because often we think of certain subjects as so complicated that we say it's not my job to know about it. But health? I mean, everyone, I believe, is keen on some or the other level about health and should take responsibility of it. So Amarji and I will be sharing about Yogananda ji. Also, you can see from the very article, this is one of our best-selling, most popular articles, the 10-point guide, that he brought the teachings of health down to simply 10 points. And he says, if you can do this, he actually said, you'll live 100 years in healthy body, mind and spirit. So I'm very eager to listen to Amarji, what he said, because each time we listen to these, even as teachers, you know, these are truths and they are very refreshing. So I'll invite Amarji to share the first 5 to 6 points. I'll elaborate on the last few. Okay. And if you have any questions, which I bet you will have, please write them on a piece of paper. And in the end, we will have 15 minutes between Amarji and myself for question answers.
Thank you, Aditya ji. Well, can we switch off these lights? A very good morning to all, and this is a great opportunity, in fact, for me to share Master's teachings, as Aditya ji has elaborated, that Master's teachings are unique in this aspect, that there is no complication about what he has said. That as far as, you know, education for life is concerned, as you can see that there are many stalls, starting from education for life, children's activities, how to achieve material success. And, you know, health is also a one big aspect of our life. And the beauty of the teachings is that his teachings are very practical. So starting from, you know, his practical aspects, we will be sharing, you know, some of these things today. And, you know, Yogananda said that human life, as you can see, can be compared with a house with three windows. And just you can imagine, if all the three windows of a house are open, you can always have good clarity, good, you know, refreshing air, good ventilation. But what are these three windows standing for? You can see that the first window here means for the soul. It's a soul window which brings us the rays of enlightenment. And we have a mental window, which is the window of the mind, which brings us the rays of equanimity, which is peace, well-being, and to stay unperturbed in difficult situations, in difficult circumstances. And then we have the physical window, which gives us the rays of vitality, the rays of healing, and the rays of health. And Master said that sometimes, you know, one of these windows is blocked, or sometimes, you know, more of these windows are blocked, and depending upon how many of them are open, the issue of health and disease can be a matter of just about these windows. So from this background, you know, I will be taking up only one aspect, which is the physical aspect, and my Guru Bhai Brahmachari Dr. Aditya will take up the mental and soul aspects in this talk in coming moments. So let us start with, you know, what Master has to say about the physical aspect and the physical window of our life. He says that take sensible care of your body and just follow the principles of health, which are just like, you know, we have some principles which are governing this universe. So there has to be some rules for the health also. Just like we have rules of the game, rules of the sports. Sometimes people say that, but why do we have sufferings? It is as simple as that because we are not following the rules of the nature. And Master was very clear. He said, don't overemphasize the importance of the body. Sometimes, you know, we become very food fattest. And, you know, sometimes just about some years back, you know, somebody asked, Master, are you a vegetarian or a non-vegetarian? And he said, you know, let us not go into that kind of debate. And he said, he coined a different word and he said, I am a properitarian. So, you know, that kind of wisdom he has brought on the planet. And so he said that just choose a balanced diet. If we have to choose one mantra, and we will be talking like what it is a balanced diet. He said, just choose a balanced diet, stick to it, and then forget the body. You know, it is as simple as that. And he said, because man has been created for a higher purpose. So it is not the physical existence to which we should be devoting our most of our energy, but we should be devoting our time to meditation and right living. And that is what we are going to talk. So I will be briefly describing, you know, some of the things, what it is which makes a balanced diet, what Master has suggested. And he said that it would be nice if we start our day with a refreshing lime. This is because lime in warm water, he says, can actually distinguish undesirable germs from the gut. You know, 2000 years back, Hippocrates, who is considered as the father of medicine, he said that all diseases begin from gut. And many of you, those who have a background in Ayurvedic philosophy, also might be seeing. And these days, you know, modern scientists are also seeing that gut is actually the brain which determines the health of the individual. Sometimes depression, sometimes people, those who have lot of, you know, dullness, it actually, the link is, you know, the gut, where they have a lot of toxins accumulating, undesirable germs which are accumulating. And that is why the whole science of probiotics has come up in the last few decades. Yeah, please, next slide. And, you know, people talk about healthy composition, where, you know, there is a lot of confusion, like how much, and this is a very simple pictorial diagram which I think can stick to our memories, like how our plate portions should be divided. As you can see that most of it, Master said that, okay, half of your plate should actually be composed of vegetables and fruits. This is because they have been prepared in the nature's kitchen. That is what Master said, that just like we cook our food in our kitchen, that is how nature is also cooking in the mother's kitchen, and the fruits are ready to be eaten and they give us ready supply of energy. And the grains, protein and other dairy products can be the rest of the plate. So as you can see in the next slide, you know, our plate should look like this, where there are a lot of greens, lot of sprouts, good amount of fresh fruits, and a portion of it is only starch and protein. It should not be other way around. So we are keeping our slides very simple so that we can go with some pictorial memories in our brains. Yeah, please, next slide. So there are certain do's and don'ts, as these are some of the things which are available in the book which is available here, the book which was written by Master. And there are the do's and don'ts are that please do not combine, you know, milk with any other meal. Milk itself is, you know, is a complete meal. So we can combine milk with fruit, but don't combine milk with any other meal. Similarly, we can combine vegetables and bread, but we should not combine starches with citrus fruits. There is a lot of logic behind it, because most of the starch gets digested in the saliva in the mouth itself, because there is an enzyme in our mouth which digests the starch. And when we take citrus fruits along with starches, this enzyme gets inactive. As a result, starch will not be properly digested. So there are a lot of food combinations which you will see in this book. I'm just touching a very few. Yes, the other principle that we need to understand is that our bodies work optimal in an alkaline medium. You know, many patients come to me because of recurrent sore throats, recurrent sinusitis, and recurrent, having viral illnesses. This is because we hardly pay attention that our bodies actually become more acidic because of wrong eating, and eating at improper times, not taking, adequate rest. So as a result, our bodies become acidic, and an acidic body is a susceptible body. That is one thing which we should, it should be one carry home message for us. So if we can keep our body alkaline, how we can keep our body alkaline? By taking a lot of fresh air, taking a lot of veggies and fruits. This can bring us the health and immunity back. So this can be a good experiment. In fact, when people have sore throats or people have viral illnesses, the best thing that they can do for themselves is that just they can do some fasting and just stay on a fruit diet and then see what happens. Maybe your bills for the doctors and clinics will get reduced. So this is how a healthy combination, buttermilk. Buttermilk is very alkaline. On including all the milk products, milk basically is alkaline. So apart from veggies, we can have buttermilk also. It is quite popular, I think, in this part of the India also. And white flour, as you can see, white flour, even the image itself can tell you that this is not bringing those vibrations of healing and vitality, as you can see in the other previous picture, which when we had a lot of green veggies and fruits. Because Master said that these refined flours, especially the bakery items, they act like a glue. And so they get deposited in our intestines, a lot of toxins, they start keep on accumulating. And we will see that many of the diseases come up because of these accumulated toxins. So when we can reduce such intake, food intake in our diet, we can, I think, stay away from many chronic illnesses. Yes, this we have covered. So keep the vegetables raw. And nuts. This is another point from Master, that he said that nuts are powerhouses of energy. And they are highly concentrated, and they should be taken in the early part of the day, because body has to, in order to digest, it has to expend a lot of energy. So we should not have nuts in the later half of our day, but rather they are a good diet in themselves if we are consuming them for a breakfast. And a word about the milk. Master said that milk is, in fact, one of the most important, foodstuffs which can supply us all the important building material for the body, which in itself is a balanced diet. In fact, nuts and milk along with fruits can be a very good breakfast for all of us, and which will supply us all the building materials. But he said that it slows the aging, and it should not be taken with meals. And a little warm milk, in fact, at night can be a good tranquilizer. People sometimes, those who have difficult sleep cycles, they can try this. And it can be used as a laxative also. If you can just put some pure ghee, just a couple of spoons into a warm milk, that can be a good laxative. And a word about the water. People have a lot of misconceptions about water, but Master is very clear. He said, don't drink water with meals. This is very important. And because the basic reason that a lot of juices come up for the digestion, and if we take water along with it, they all dilute it. As a result, digestion will not be effective. And especially ice water. I don't see ice water as much here in this part as I used to see in North India. There, because of the extremes of temperature, you know, people are used to having ice water and cold water with their meals. And Master said that when we do that, we are actually, you know, playing havoc with our health, because this can even push us to diabetes, because the digestion will be hampered because there is a lot of fire in the stomach to digest the food. And just imagine if we put ice water on it, what will happen? And let hunger be your guide. You know, this is very important. Many times, you know, people just say, okay, this is 1 o'clock. Okay, this is my lunchtime. I must sit on my dining table for my lunch now. But then this is what he said, that people, those who are doing this, they're actually skating on thin ice. And just have your food only when you have appetite, when you have hunger. If you're not feeling hungry, there's no need to gulp food. You can even avoid, and you will see that how even small changes can make big changes in your health. Small lifestyle changes can actually show a big leap in your health just over a period of maybe days together. So this I have already showed you how a good breakfast can be there. And you know, we are not devoting much time about the flower essences. You know, one aspect of health which Master has suggested, maybe sometime later we can have a full talk on flower remedies. And where Master suggested that every foodstuff, right from vegetable, fruits, they have some spiritual quality to offer. Like banana, for example, can give us humility. Oranges can give us joy. Lettuce can give us peace and calmness. Almonds can give us self-control. So, you know, every foodstuff, when it is a concentrated essence can be taken out, which is usually taken from the flowers, because flowers have the concentrated form and the essence vitality of that particular component. And when we take that, there are subtle biochemical as well as neurochemical changes in our brain and also in the heart, how the emotions are processed. And that can help us, you know, in bringing up good natural mental and emotional qualities in ourselves. And now so physical diet, you know, was this much only. And now Master said that never forget that apart from the physical diet, we should also incorporate the magnetic diet of sunshine and oxygen. You know, many times we say that, okay, I have taken my 3 meals and we just forget it. But then our bodies are actually operating like a dry cell battery. So just like you may say that it is like a solar cell battery. It is a combination of dry cell battery and a solar cell battery. So we need, just like leaves, what will happen to the plants? Human beings have evolved from plant life, from animal life. So we need also sunlight, just like leaves need sunlight for photosynthesis in order to make the food. So if we are not going in to refresh ourselves in the sun and refreshing air, then obviously we are actually making our bodies sicker. So what he said, that and sunshine and oxygen are actually direct energy producing qualities. And if we inhale and exhale several times outdoors, especially when we are tired, he said, okay, you're feeling tired in the office. If you have some balcony, just go out and do some inhalation and exhalation 6 times or maybe 12 times and see what happens. Some of these things we will be doing with you in the next half. So I'm just touching these concepts in principle. How to remain youthful? You know, everybody wants to stay youthful. Nobody wants to age. So what are the mantras for staying youthful? Master said daily exercise. Walk daily. That is a simple exercise. Just go for a leisure walk, 20 minutes. No need to, you know, do brisk running. And bathe your body in sunshine. Breathe the fresh, crisp air of winters. That is what Master has said. How many of us do that? You know, winters, we just try to cuddle ourselves in the, you know, quilts and blankets. Nobody likes to go out. But Master is saying, go out, you know, in the winters. Go out and have a crisp air, refreshing air. And that way, you know, you'll be able to make yourself healthier. And he said, perform some sort of exercise. You know, people ask, how much should I exercise? You know, so what is the benchmark? He said, which is just enough to bring you perspiration. That can be you know, because every individual has a different capacity. So going by yogic rule, which is just enough to bring you perspiration over your forehead, that's fine. So for a younger individual, it can be a little higher, but for elderly, it can be a little lower. sufficient sleep. You know, many people are coming to me, especially youngsters. They have such a chaotic, you know, lifestyle as well as working schedule that they are not having enough sleep. As a result, they are not actually enjoying their prime of their health. This is because, and Master said that, how is it that sleep is not possible? He said that sleep can be induced at will by lying on the back, closing the eyes, tensing and relaxing the body, and dismissing all thoughts. So he has put it very easily, but then for some of us, you know, it could be very, very difficult, you know, those who are not able to get sleep. And those who are not able to get sleep, probably they need some change in the lifestyle. And healthy teeth, as many of us know, that diseased teeth, they produce many ills. And after eating, Master said, see how practical he was, that we may not be carrying a toothbrush with us. Because it is not always, if you are having your food maybe in your office, he said that, okay, rinse your mouth with water 10 times. That's all. That is as good as brushing your teeth. Periodic fasting. He said one of the main causes of arthritis, rheumatism, and many other diseases is auto-intoxication. This is that the food, the waste material that keeps on accumulating inside our guts, and from those toxins, when they start accumulating in the joints, we start getting arthritis. In fact, if you just recall that this year's Nobel Prize in Medicine has gone to a scientist who has done all his research on fasting. This is, he said that when we fast, the cells in our body, they go into a kind of auto clearance mode. They start disposing of the waste material. Just like we do some Diwali cleaning in our houses once in a year. This is how, you know, bodies also need cleaning, cells also need cleaning. And when we do fasting, we are actually switching on that switch in our body, which tells the body that, okay, you can do some house cleaning now, and there will not be next batch of food coming into, you know, which you need for, you know, putting your energy. And he said that, okay, even if you can't do it weekly, there are many ways, you know, of fasting, which you will read in this book. But then a 3-day fast or a weekly fast just on an orange juice with some laxative at night can expel the poisons. You know, it is as simple as that. Oranges are freely available. We can have orange juice. I mean, there's nothing there which should be a hindrance for any one of us. And yeah, so this is my last slide. And Master said that don't forget to smile. This is because there is no better reviving tonic than a genuine smile. And no beauty greater than the smile of peace and wisdom glowing on your face. So with that, you know, I'll hand over to Aditya ji, who will be, you know, teaching, who will be guiding us into some workshops. And we will be doing some of these things that we have discussed. So that, and we'll see how practically these are beneficial.
Take some questions now on
the
board itself.
Okay. Maybe, okay. Yeah. So if we have questions on up to this much, that we can take. Yeah.
You mentioned about fasting.
Yes.
Only orange, nothing else, orange juice.
See, actually, I touched only one way in which Master has described fasting in many different ways. There can be a partial fast, there can be a complete fast, there can be a 9-day fast, or there can be just, you know, even skipping a meal. Just two meals or maybe one meal in a week can be a kind of partial fast. Let us say I'm not feeling hungry, and so I should not be eating at that time. And if I just have, and if I'm feeling little hungry, then I can have a little fruit or some milk. You know, that is also a kind of fast. So for some of us, this 3-day fasting only on orange juice can be a very high, you know, pedestal. But then we can always start with some kind of partial fasting, like skipping a meal, at least not having food when we are not feeling hungry, and maybe just taking a fruit portion, taking some glass of milk in the night. Especially in the night, Master has talked, we should not have heavy meals. This is because most of it remains undigested, because digestion also runs with the solar rhythm. You know, if you see in Ayurveda, we have a solar center, Manipur Chakra, which runs with the sun, and the peak sun activity is between 10 to 2 p.m. So we should have the best of our food intake between that period. So there can be many ways in which this is not necessarily the only way. Yeah.
So can we take all kinds of fruits with milk or?
Yeah, this is what in general he has recommended, that fruits and milk is a good combination because both are alkaline. But yes, citrus fruits, I can say that they may be avoided, but I see people putting strawberries into, you know, making a good milk custard or whatever. So that's fine, yeah. So, but the citrus, as far as possible, you can avoid. But like, you know, any sweet fruit like dates or chiku or, you know, mango or whatever, we can put. Banana, we can be easily mixed with milk.
Okay, and you said we should not take water with milk.
Yeah.
But buttermilk is fine.
Buttermilk is fine, yeah, absolutely. Buttermilk, in fact, with milk can be a good digestant. And in fact, even before the diet, can be actually help you give a little appetizing effect. Yes. Yes. Yeah, there should be some time actually, because you see lemon, because maybe that can be the first thing after having your brushing. And usually, you know, there is always 1.5 to 2 hour gap between, you know, brushing your teeth and having your breakfast. So if we have about that much amount of gap, let us say 1.5 to 2 hours, that would be ideal. So, yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Amarji. We can have the lights on now and the PowerPoint closed. So that was interesting, no? Such simple things, like I was mentioning in the introduction, that we often think of health, oh my goodness, I have to seek a specialist for that. And it's good, you know, they do know much. But sometimes we can forget the basics in the quest for something exotic. And I'd like to now come to my topic for the next about 15 minutes. I'll be sharing on the health, deeper aspects of health, in the sense of, Yogarandaji said, we focus sometimes too much on the diet and we forget that we may be taking in a totally wrong mental diet. So what is a mental diet, for example? Or sometimes he said that our environment where we live or work is much stronger than our willpower to have, you know, adequate health of physical or mental kind. So I want to little bit touch on this subject, that Paramhansa Yogananda said that the entire yoga science is based on the understanding that our physical body is actually made, like I mentioned in the previous class touchingly, from a blueprint of our energy body, which he says is the product of thoughts, what he called the causal body. Now, how does this fit in the picture? Because we don't see those two bodies, you know, even if we have it or not, as especially when I was training, I didn't know. And even now I cannot say I've seen them, but can we feel it? Yes. Can we make a lot of changes in our physical body based on energy changes? Absolutely. That is why we are trying to know these. So first of all, there is a question we may have. I certainly had it when I was training. Why are some children, why do they not even see the light of the day? Why do they die in their mother's wombs? They were not even given the opportunity to be born, to acquire bad habits, maybe good habits. Why, again, do many of us have, let's say, some or the other sort of congenital illness? I remember it was in Pune many years ago. I was preparing for a pediatric quiz as a medical student, and I went in depth in the study of syndromes that newborns may have. There are thousands and thousands of them which describe a deformity in the ears, in the eyes, in the throat, heart, feet, legs, spine, brain. And I used to wonder, because, you know, as a doctor, you're trying to help people come out of pain and illness. And I said, but what do you do about that? Another time, the real deal breaker for me was, I was assisting a surgery in Delhi. It was almost a 7-8 hour surgery. We were operating on a 1 week old child who had intestinal tumor. And earlier, when we started operating, it was an obstruction. So we said, okay, let's operate on this. It's an obstruction. We have to relieve it. But when we reached the part, there was a tumor. And I was just so clueless as a young surgeon. I looked around. I asked my professors, I said, how did he get a tumor? He's barely a week old. And there Paramhansa Yogananda said that what we are seeing, like Buddha said also, he says, we today are the sum total of all our actions and thoughts in the past. And he says those thoughts, for example, I'll make it even more simpler, because these things do take a lot of time to understand. How did you come here today? Today we are all sitting in this room, but it starts when you may have had a thought, when you see you probably saw the ad on Facebook or in the newspaper or some friend told you, and you see the ad and you have, that looks like a good thing. So you have a thought, I'll go for this weekend class. But just by thinking in your chair at your house, would you have arrived over here? Would you have? No, it would have remained a very good thought. And then people say, the way to hell is lined by good intentions, that we may have all the best intentions, but if we don't act on a certain prescription, it won't help us. So thought is a very good step, but Yoga Ananda says that is step one. He says, that thought, you gave energy. Okay, I'm going to drive my car, maybe from Hadapsar to Ashok Nagar. I'll spend some money. I will spend my time, a few hours, a whole day. That is energy. And Yogananda says that's the second step. After thought, you get energy. And he says, when you have those two right, based on how much you've put it out, your manifestation will be here. So our willpower, ultimately, when attuned to what Yogananda called divine will, produces optimum health. Health comprises not just of physical health in the body, that is a very good sign, but Master says we also have to take care of our mental health. Now, beautifully, very beautifully, Amarji, you know, encapsulated those points, because sometimes if we think, where is that energy coming from? Where are those thoughts coming from? I don't even know if I've lived in the past. But I would let you delve on those points. But even what Amarji has right now shared is very, very vital, because who cares about the past and who has seen the future? What is happening right now is more important. This morning I was reading in the newspaper that news I had read actually 12 years ago, United Nations at that time had declared that we have just the planet. People think, oh, this planet, there are still so many people starving. Well, let me console you. In 2004, our planet for the first time saw more overweight people. More than 3.5 billion people were overweight and lesser of them were underweight. Yes, this morning I read 74% of the global population is overweight. I mean, where are we going in a span of 12 years? So if we can just, and yesterday I was having a chat with one of our friends. I visited a store, Decathlon. They have some beautiful sports equipment, beautiful cycles and, you know, adventure equipment. And I said, I just bought a whole bunch of it because it is so nice to spend your money into proper diet, into some proper exercise, into good habits. Just coming out in the sun, just being in air is very nice. But as we progress with the commitment on the spiritual path, it is good for us to keep our discrimination open that some things, actually Kriyananda ji, whose teachings we are also sharing, once somebody asked him, how much of my present is dictated by my past lives? He says, well, let's accept it, almost all. Which is to say again that, again, I would leave this for you to explore in the book, but Kriyananda said, if you have a very disturbed emotion, let's say in this life or towards somebody, first of all, nowadays we are developing that awareness where you say, I just don't want to get angry. I don't like it when I'm angry. I don't like it. People often ask me, what do I do about jealousy? I just can't seem to get rid of it. Because in the moment it may feel nice, but it is not a good emotion to harbor. And that energy of thought, of our behavior, of our environment takes a toll on us. And now I'll bring the topic to mental health. Yogananda ji said that the kind of thoughts we keep are very, very vital to the, you know, health we will have subsequently. Also, all of you probably know, mental health illnesses are on a very, very rapid, sharp ascent. Again, because people have stopped, I think, connecting with nature, but also because of the lack of harmony in their relationships. How do we establish mental health? Let me give an example. We have the conscious mind of ours, which I believe all of you are employing right now. Conscious is when somebody asks you a question in the moment, you are able to give a logical reply through your senses. What's my name? My name is Aditya. I'm a doctor. I'm talking right now. So I'm aware of these things. If somebody were to ask me a deeper question about, let's say, a habit I may have, for example, I don't know if you're noticing, I once in a while jerk my shoulder backwards. So somebody may say, why is that happening? I'll have to pause and think, and I'll say, maybe, I don't know, but it's just something, maybe I've started doing it more now. But we have these subconscious tendencies, habits, likes and dislikes. And Yogananda ji said, those reside in our mind, and they actually are called samskars, those we bring from past lives. And it is the subconscious mind, which Kriyananda was saying, to a large degree is dictating our present likes and dislikes and our habits. Now, knowing such a sorry state of affairs, in the Gita also Krishna declares that there are so many lives. He tells Arjuna, oh Arjuna, you do not remember, but I remember all the past lives you've lived. And hence he could help him. Likewise, these teachings of Yogananda ji, for mental health, he gave us a tool called affirmations. He was speaking, now many people talk of affirmations, which I think is a wonderful trend. But he was talking of this about a century ago, when nobody had even heard of that term. He used another term. He says, meditation and affirmations for mental health will take you into a state of super consciousness. People said, what is super consciousness? Subconscious, yes, when we are sleeping, when we are drowsy, we are in the subconscious. Right now we are conscious. He says, if you lift your awareness of your, many times, I have seen patients, they have a back problem, and I'll tell them, lie down straight, and they lie down somewhat like this, or I tell them, tense your buttock. Will you believe this? One time I was with a patient for almost, because I had to go to another one, 15 to 20 minutes I tried. I said, tense your buttock. He said, I'm trying, I can't. I said, tense your buttock. And he said, how? I said, I put my finger over there. I said, here. I said, tense this muscle. I was showing him. He couldn't get a hang or a control of his buttock because we are not, let's say, exercising. We are not aware of a body part. If you're not aware of a body part, what is the chance that you will throw a habit out of your brain just because it's disturbing you? Let's say alcoholism, smoking, unbiased fears, unreasonable fears. Now, doctors have found out that in the brain, there are places where anxiety, fear, apprehension, restlessness is situated. And there's another part of the brain where calmness, maternal love, proper decision making, intuition. I'm talking of neurosurgical books here. Maternal love is described in the leading neurosurgical text of the world. They have mapped those areas and they say they are situated in the prefrontal part of the brain where ladies put a bindi. It is the point between the two eyebrows. That is the point we awaken when we concentrate deeply and especially when we can keep our eyes up. And we taught that in the class in meditation last time, and I will take us through a similar practice. The point I'm trying to make is, if, and I believe all of us are in that boat, if we find ourselves handicapped in any emotional situation, there is a way out by the practice of affirmations. And I'm going to take two affirmations right now. An affirmation is a statement of truth, which when repeated with concentration, brings about the desired change. So shall we practice this for 5 to 7 minutes? Okay.
Can I have a glass of water?
Yes.
Please sit upright now. This is a book of ours called Affirmations for Self-Healing. And I have picked the affirmation for energy. Now, is energy important? I would like this to be slightly interactive before we go into the affirmation. Is energy important for us? Yeah, imagine if the power went out right now. Oh, except kids or everybody else. Kids are very happy when power goes out. It's something about them. Then, do we need energy to come to the class? To absorb the facts? And do we need energy to apply these facts in our lives? So now let's listen to what Kriyananda ji says about energy. And take this in the physical form, but also take it as mental energy and prana. Energy is ours not when we hoard our strength, but when we devote it willingly, joyously, toward the attainment of that in which we deeply believe. Faith and energy go hand in hand. If you have deep faith in what you are doing, you can move mountains. Energy is always highest when one's cause is just. The greater one's faith, the greater his willpower. And the greater his willpower, the greater his flow of energy. And for a brief moment, let's close our eyes. And based on these lines, let's think of some personalities we may know who had those qualities of faith, energy, willpower. Maybe Gandhiji. Maybe some prominent sports person. Maybe Buddha. Jesus. Some very committed actor. Faith, willpower, energy. Exceedingly successful, honest businessman. Faith, willpower, energy. A very healthy person, perhaps in your own family. Faith, their willpower, joy, translating as energy. And now, please repeat these lines after me. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Now keeping your eyes closed, focusing deeply at the point between the two eyebrows, affirm only mentally as I say this aloud. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. Within me lies the energy to accomplish all that I will to do. Behind my every act is God's infinite power. And now mentally allow this prayer to rise from your heart and your brain to God. O cosmic energy, vitalize all the cells of my body. Recharge my mind with boundless inspiration. Fill my soul with thy inexhaustible joy. Let's meditate for a minute on these words, feeling their power on our body and our mind. Feel the awakening of this energy within you, your body, your mind, your resolution. Awakened by the application of deep concentration and willpower through this affirmation. We will now affirm another quality of good health. Let's listen to the words before. Good health is more than the state of not being ill. It is a radiant state of inner well-being. Physical illnesses may be cured by medicines. No medicine, however, can induce that state of boundless energy which comes when every cell in the body cooperates with the mind willingly, joyfully in all that it seeks to do. Such radiant well-being comes after the mind has been cleared of every shadow of unwillingness, of fear, and of doubt. When one has learned to say yes to life, and when one has learned to love. Now please repeat after me aloud. My body cells obey my will. They dance with divine vitality. I am well. I am strong. I am a flowing river of boundless power and energy. My body cells obey my will. They dance with divine vitality. I am well. I am strong. I am a boundless river of power and energy. My body cells obey my will. They dance with divine vitality. I am well. I am strong. I am a flowing river of boundless power and energy. My body cells obey my will. They dance with divine vitality. I am well. I am strong. I am a flowing river of boundless power and energy. I am a flowing river of boundless power and energy. My body cells obey my will. They dance with divine vitality. I am well. I am strong. I am a flowing river of boundless power and energy. And now deep focus at the spiritual eye. Let's repeat this only mentally. My body cells obey my will. They dance with divine vitality. I am well. I am strong. I am a flowing river of boundless power and energy. My body cells obey my will. They dance with divine vitality. I am well. I am strong. I am a flowing river of boundless power and energy. Mentally, allow this prayer to go from your heart to God. O mighty source of all that is right and good, help me to see my strength as an expression of thy infinite power. Let me banish the darkness of disease. It is forever foreign to thy light. It is forever foreign to thy light. Let's meditate for about a minute on these words. Feel the power awakened through these affirmations of energy and good health resonating, resounding in you. From now on, making you choose the right things in life, in your diet, habits, banishing fears and darknesses. See and feel your body cells dancing with vitality. Yogananda ji would say, how often do we speak to our body cells? Most of us never. Let's take this moment in silence to feel the body cells in different body parts. Feel their vitality and dancing in your left hand, in the fingers, palms, the blood flowing through your forearm, the bones in the joints. Feel it in the right arm now. Thank your fingers for serving you, helping create your mental desires, fulfill your ambitions. Focus on the chest and thank your lungs for every breath they have brought. Thank your heart for its endless, tireless service. Thank your voice, your teeth, the tongue, eyes and nose and ears. Appreciate them. Thank the brain for orchestrating all of this so seamlessly. Thank all the abdominal organs, your spine, nerves and legs. And try now to feel behind the physical body yourself as energy currents, prana. And behind the quality of that prana, think of the thoughts that have brought us here and carry the potential to take us ever higher. And expand that identity beyond this planet. See yourself sitting in this room, but part of the solar system, our galaxy, which is one of the 300 billion galaxies they have found and are finding ever more with every passing day. In this enormity, let us express deep gratitude to that unseen power that sustains the trees, the sun, the wind, water, fishes and birds, everyone, the divine intelligence in every cell, of which we are the product of. Let us bow inwardly to that cosmic intelligence. And let's end by doing a practical visualization called Om chanting mentally. I will say the Om aloud and you chant it mentally in different body parts. Yogananda ji says this simple technique brings deep relaxation followed by healing from different tensions, aches, even fractures. Keeping your eyes closed and slightly uplifted, lest you fall asleep, Think of your left big toe. And mentally chant Om in the nail bed. Om. Only mentally, in your mind. Now we will chant Om in all the four fingers. Om. 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 Feel them relaxed, nourished. Let us chant Om in the right foot, on the great toe and the fingers. Om. 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 The last finger, Om. Now at the sole of your feet, both feet together, feel the Om vibration emanating from the ground, relaxing the soles of your feet. Om. Ankle joints. Om. Calf muscles and the back side of the knee joint. Om. Knee, thighs and buttocks. Base of spine, intestines, lungs and heart. Om. Include the hands. Neck and throat. Om. Om. The teeth, tongue, face, eyes, brain. Om. Please chant Om with me 3 times with your eyes closed, focusing at the point between the 2 eyebrows. Keeping your eyes closed, mentally scan the body now. Feel the deep rest and relaxation of the body tissues. Feel them expressing thanks to you. Receive it, promising to return them these blessings over and over again in your daily practice of meditation, affirmation, yoga, and exercise. Let's rub our hands together now. Share these peaceful vibrations with anyone you know who is in need of healing, whether here in the room or at a distance. Raise your hands above the shoulders now. Let's chant Om three times. Past by 5 minutes, but this is how Yogananda ji presented the complete picture of health. You know, we often read, there are so many definitions of a subject like this, a topic like health, but Master would again and again bring it to all the three components. I want to read a few lines of how he begins actually his commentary on health. He says, human life can be likened to a house fitted with the three windows of body, mind, and soul. Through these openings come pouring the three different rays responsible for man's physical health, mental equanimity, and soul enlightenment. Man has the independence and free will to live in the house of life with its three windows open or closed. When man closes the windows of life, which he means the physical body, the energy body, and our thoughts, he shuts out the three divine rays and finds himself living in the darkness of physical disease, mental disquietude, and abysmal soul ignorance. Most people have had one or more of their windows of life jammed shut for years. As a result, they suffer from chronic maladies. Their remedy lies in discovering how to open those windows themselves and bask once again in the all-healing rays of the divine. So that picture that we often think, dream of a healthy life through and through is a reality, used to be a reality, I believe, in olden days. But we can once again affirm that reality, as he says, by choosing those qualities. So I encourage now you all to follow the guidelines as Amarji has explained. And much more information is there in this beautiful tiny little book called Glowing Health and Vitality. And then we have another beautiful book of Swami Kriyananda, Affirmations for Self-Healing. He gives 52 affirmations. So we can practice, take one of them and practice it for every week, morning, evening, and we repeat it many times till we become that quality. Actually, an interesting thing he said was, we don't acquire these qualities from outside. He says, all these soul qualities, let's say of good health and energy that we discussed, are already in our soul. It's like the DNA. But because we have not experienced them, we have forgotten them. So we are kind of reminding ourselves by aloud affirmations and such. We are bringing them out from within ourselves.